Hi everyone, it's Raina. So this is a video that is long overdue, and it's going to be the first in a series of videos on my favorite things. Yeah, just like Oprah. But this is going to be more metaphysical because, as you can see, I have some tarot decks, I have some oracle card decks, and these are the decks that I use on a frequent basis. And I want to give you some introduction to them. If you have never seen some of these decks, I'm showing the backs of them, which is always fun. And I'm also going to be providing links for all of these decks below because I am creating an Amazon affiliate page. I want to do this type of video with my favorite books and even some supplies, like I have a couple of incense types that they're like my go-to brands. And also there was this rose water spray that's really cool. But I'll probably do that in a later video. I'm most passionate about books, even more so than tarot and oracle decks. So that's going to be something that'll be a lot of fun, and I might even break that up into two parts. But I'm creating an Amazon affiliate page because the owner of Amazon, Jeff Bezos, has more money than God. And so if I'm going to promote his store and provide links to where people can purchase it, there's no reason why I can't partake in any of the profits. But I'm selective in the things I'm presenting because I consider myself a person of integrity, and I don't just promote things that I'm lukewarm about or I don't even like. As a matter of fact, I've started this video over several times because I decided to eliminate a few of the decks that I really am not that keen on. And it was specifically because I want to be just promoting things that I feel I really resonate with. However, and you know, overall, because everything has its little imperfections, obviously, that I would change. But the other thing to note is that just because I like something doesn't mean that you'll like something. So I can't guarantee that anybody else will like it. But I feel like this is a bit superior to the reviews on Amazon because I have been influenced by some of those reviews. And I'm not saying that they were paid reviews, but I just did not enjoy the cards the way that these other people raved about them. There have been decks, and I'm like, I can't work with this. I mean, this doesn't really resonate with me. And they're beautiful. The actual physical quality is wonderful, but the definitions and the oracles themselves just are a little bit weird, or they're not workable. These decks all have universal messages as far as I'm concerned. So let us start with the two tarot decks. The first one is the classic Rider-Waite deck. And I also had a Radiant Rider-Waite deck. And let me see if I even have, you know, I probably do have an example. You know, even though I don't have the whole deck, I can at least show you what it looks like. I loved this back. And this is what it looks like. Okay, the front of it. Now, I prefer, I'll put this down, maybe I'll link that, because some people may really like that. And I certainly do think it jumps out at you, but this is an example of the kind of coloring of the, I don't know what they call this, it's just like the traditional Rider-Waite deck. The colors to me are more muted, but some people may prefer that. The first deck I had, I believe, was that Radiant Tarot, and I did like it. I mean, it's going to have very similar, I think it is the same depictions. It just has bigger letters for the different cards, and then also it's the dye is brighter. Now, with the traditional Rider-Waite deck, whether you get the Radiant Tarot, as I said, or you get the, whatever this is called, just the regular, these are Pamela Coleman drawings. And I feel that if you're beginning the tarot, that this is your go-to deck. Because I'll give you an example, and I just started this video again after having gotten into it, and I used the example of the Fool card. Look at, don't just look at the person, the fact they're carrying a very small knapsack, so they're traveling light. This is a card, the Fool card is a card of, you know, embarking on a new path in life, but also not really caring where you're going. And hence, the person's like looking up in the sky. It looks like their eyes are even closed. Or well, I don't know, they might be open, but the person's on a cliff. And you see the dog is like looking at the person, maybe warning them, hey, you're about to fall off this cliff if you don't look where you're going. And again, think about what the Fool represents. Holding a flower in their hand, like a flower child. Now, the idea is that the person is embarking on a journey, but it's about the journey, not the destination. Okay? And it's a zero, the first card. It's an unknown quantity. But there's always the risk that the person is not really looking where they're leaping, and they have to, and they may be doing something too rashly. They may be not grounded enough, and so that's that deck. Now let me get the deck I use in my readings, the writer, Morgan Greer deck. Okay. Now, let's compare these two. Both depicting somebody with a knapsack. The dog in both pictures, the flower, the white flower in both pictures. But there's no cliff here. You see mountains in the background, but there's no cliff. So the thing is that extra detail means a lot. It packs more into the reading itself. And even the sun is more prominent, okay, than in this card. You can see it, but, you know, it kind of can get lost. Now, if you look at other comparisons, there's no border on the Morgan Greer deck. They both have yellow in the background, so colors are important, I found out, that they represent different moods. And that gives an added layer. Some of the decks, and one particular deck that I did not include, it did not make my final cut of this, for this the cards that I chose for this video, did not have much variance in the back. Yes, they did have different colors to represent the different elements, I believe, but overall the cards had a uniformity that made them all kind of blend together. So that was one of the reasons why I wasn't really keen on that deck. Why is the Morgan Greer deck the one that I go to now? I think for one thing, I like the feel of these in my hand. There's a feeling of substance. There's a feeling of gravitas. That's another thing that you have to be aware of, is that some decks have flimsy cards, and in addition to the fact that they may tear more easily and have a shorter lifespan, you also have to consider that the feeling of them, if they don't feel solid to you, if they feel like kind of like they could just float away, then the message itself may seem very tenuous. So that's why I prefer to use the Morgan Greer deck. The Rider-Waite deck has pretty solid cards themselves. Not as, I don't know if I would say they're as thick as the Morgan Greer, but it's not very different. And I do feel that even with the fact that the Morgan Greer deck is very similar to the Rider-Waite deck in terms of the depiction of the different meanings, there are some variances that make it so that if you're first starting out, I would definitely recommend going the traditional route with Rider-Waite and then branching out. But I have definitely seen in other decks that they do not depict what's happening in a sophisticated way. They might have like a couple of elements for each card's meaning, but it's not something that a beginner would be able to discern. And when you're first starting out, it's not only a question of like memorizing the meanings of the cards, but also what you put, you know, what you bring to the card. And if there's too much sameness between each card, then it becomes kind of like it blurs, one blends into the other too much, okay? So then let's move on to the deck. Well, let me leave that for last because that's kind of like my favorite deck in a way. I was going to talk about the the one, the Keepers of the Light. I keep forgetting the name of that deck, which is the top right. But I'm going to save that for last. Now, the next deck is an Oracle card deck called The Wisdom of the Oracles. And this one definitely has very good card stock. This is an example. I just took it off the top, the Fates. Oh, and it's the 17th. How apropos. But you can see the artwork, how beautiful it is. I mean, it just, when you get decks that have a lot of beautiful imagery, it's so inspiring. It's so pleasant. Here's another one, Message in a Bottle. Look at those colors. Look at the intricacy and the delightful aspect of it. So, why do I like this deck? Well, first off, it's very straightforward. There is, when you look at the booklet that comes with it, it's something that you can really apply to your readings. And whether you're doing this professionally, for fun, maybe you're just serious about it, but you're just doing it for your own personal use, I think that you're going to find that you get a clear-cut message or synchronicity from it. Whereas some of these quirkier decks, they may have beautiful images, but the messages to me are convoluted, and that's what I was trying to convey before when I was talking about this. I don't want to call out any decks because it's my subjective opinion, and I don't want to discourage people from buying certain decks that they feel called to buy, because people do have an influence on other people's buying habits. And that's not what I'm all about. I'm about promoting things. So anyway, that's what I like about that deck. And another great thing about the Wisdom of the Oracle deck is that it also has meanings for love. So if you were doing a love reading, you could just like ignore some of the other stuff and then just talk about the love. And it has what they call protection message, which is if the card is reversed. And I know that some people do not believe in reversed cards and they don't deal with them. But I feel like if a card turns up reversed, there's a reason for it and we have to look at it. Now, if you are holding the deck upside down, that's on you. And I kind of like do it in a modified way, because sometimes I do hold the deck upside down, and I always like let people know that I saw that two cards in a row came out reversed, and I looked and I was holding the deck upside down, so now I'm turning it upright and having it both ways, I guess. Okay, so that's that deck, and then we come to a deck that I really enjoy. This is the Earth Magic deck. And let me just pick a card from here randomly. Rainbow Blessing. So you can see beautiful artwork. And this is another deck where the booklet really has great interpretations that are very straightforward. It's not eccentric. It's not convoluted. It's very just clear. And I feel that that makes it much more relatable with people. I also have liked some of the cards that have come up. I just said rainbow, but they have like these nature images, like for instance, fog veiled, or autumn equinox release. So these are things that people can really connect with, they can feel on a visceral level, and that makes this deck. It's also a very beautiful, glossy finish, like some of these other decks, and very durable. Very good feel in the hands. And then the last deck that I'm going to talk about today is the Native Spirit deck. And I will pick a card from this. Okay, like I keep getting this card, Great Mystery. And it's nice, this one out of, I was going to say out of all the decks, but of this in the Earth Magic deck, I think this one is very much connected to Native American wisdom. And so this is especially good for people that are into Earth religion and that sort of thing, Native American religion. You really connect with nature. And especially with the Native American spirituality, because they seem to be very much, it's not like, it doesn't feel watered down to me. It feels very authentic and grounded. And I think that these two decks, the Earth Magic and the Native Spirit, it makes things a lot more down to earth, relatable, and therefore practical. Being too theoretical, being too abstract, doesn't really help people on a day-to-day basis. It can be interesting, stimulating intellectually, but not necessarily that tangible and therefore usable, you know, for your everyday life. And I think, and I always strive to bring things down to that level. So the last deck is the Keepers of the Light. Give you an example of one of these cards. And it has these, and then it says, you know, it has the different, whatever you call them, Ascended Master or something. Like this one says, you already know the answer you seek. Trust what you know. So even if you were not to use the booklet, you could still give a reading and kind of put in your own information or just opinion on the reading. But the booklet really is great because it goes into who this person was, what they represent, and also gives like ideas of what to do. So that's a form of guidance. Again, it has nice feel in the hands. And what I like about it, too, is that the pictures are all different with different colors. I really love color. And they are from different, what would we say, like schools of thought or religious backgrounds. This is Bridget. I think you would associate that with paganism. I don't know, maybe it's part of the saints in Catholicism, not sure. But then we have this one, I'm not even going to attempt to, Shekinah, I don't know, but is that, I don't know if this is Egyptian. And some of these, a lot of them I wasn't familiar with. So it's very nice, kind of diverse influences that can expand you as well as stimulate your thinking, give you a different way to look at your situation, and that's what it's all about, you know? I don't think that readings are meant to ever be somebody telling you what to do so that you don't have have to make your own choices in life, but to kind of give you food for thought, and then you can take it from there and make your own connections with your life. And also to inspire. I think that's a really big part of this. And I find all of these decks inspiring in their own way. Okay, you guys, I did it. This is the first one. So I hope that this was at least entertaining for you and informative, I should say. So take care, you guys. Bye.